Forensics for beginners. In this video, which is titled as Volatile Memory Forensics to Detect Malware, the technique to identify the presence of malicious code which is injected in the running process in the code section of the running legitimate process in the volatile memory is discussed. The cyber attacker, in order to perform their malicious task, either way they installed some malware onto the particular computer system. But these kinds of malware which are having their signature, okay, so the particular antivirus program, so they identify the signature of such particular malicious code. So those particular program can be detected by the antivirus program. But if the code injection have been performed by the cyber attacker, in that case, the particular code injected which is in the particular legitimate running process cannot be detected by the antivirus program. So that's why this particular video I have created so that the technique of finding out the code injection in the running process, which is the legitimate running process, can be identified. So to begin with, we'll discuss about some basics about the code injection and how that particular code injection can be performed in the running legitimate process. So now, as all we know that a particular volatile memory, that is the main memory, is having the mainly two sections or two parts, like a user space and the system space. So our application program runs in the user space and the system related programs runs in the system area. So the cyber attacker, what they does, so they try to gain or compromise the control of the legitimate running process which are running in the user space. So what they does, because already any application program, they require the services of the system program. So if the particular application program which is running in the user space, so if it have been compromised by the cyber attacker, then those particular application program, they will try to seek the resources or the services of the system program. So that way the system, the access to the system program can be gained by the particular cyber attacker. So how they can do? So for that purpose, the cyber attacker, either way, they will install a malware onto the system, but that particular malware can be detected by the antivirus program. So the antivirus program, they search for a particular signature of that particular malicious code, and that way they detect that particular presence of the malicious code. But the cyber attacker, to avoid the detection of the particular malicious code by the antivirus program, they inject their malicious code in the legitimate running process. So where they inject? Into the particular legitimate process. A particular running process is going to have various files or data associated with that. A running process is going to have some file like an executable file, or it may have a DLL file in case of Windows operating system. A particular portable executable file of a running process is made up of various sections. The first section is going to be a header section, next is a code section, data section, and any other resource related information sections. So the cyber attacker, they try to gain the access to the code section, and they inject the code section in that some malicious code in the code section of the particular portable executable file. So once that particular code section have been altered by using the code injection, and if the particular running process have been executed by the microprocessor, certainly that code section will get executed and it will do the required task of that particular cyber attacker. Now there is a concept about the memory mapped information or the memory mapped file. A particular portable executable file is a memory mapped file because that particular file is going to be required all the time. So the operating system is required to load that particular memory mapped file into the volatile memory. Entire file is required to be brought from the hard disk and is required to be loaded into the volatile memory. So such file is called as a memory map file. So what the particular cyber attacker does, they used to try to compromise such kind of memory map file. So that's why the digital forensic investigation of the volatile memory is important. So by using the digital forensic investigation of volatile memory, what kind of information we can get? In the previous video related to the volatile memory forensics, already I discussed about how we can extract the registry key related data from the volatile memory. So for that purpose, I discussed the technique and by using the relationship between the various volatile memory structures. So by using the describing the relationship between the volatile memory structure, we are able to find out the registry key related data, that is the name of the registry key and its value from the volatile memory dump, and from that we can reconstruct the user activity. So this is one of the thing that we can extract the registry key related data from the volatile memory dump. So apart from that, we can detect the presence of some malware or malicious code running in the volatile memory. So that also it is possible by doing the volatile memory forensics. That means suppose some there is unknown program is running in the volatile memory, so that unknown program also can be we can find out by using the performing the forensic investigation of the volatile memory. So that is also one of the possibility that is the importance of performing the volatile memory forensics. Now already I discussed that how we can detect the presence of the particular code section injection. That means if you are doing the suppose the cyber attacker had injected some malicious code into the code section of the running process, that means in the portable executable file and its code section, so then how we can detect that particular malicious code injection. So for that purpose, we have to know first of all what are the memory file, which are the file which have been memory mapped in the volatile memory. Thereafter, we have to look at the code section of the particular running process, that means of that particular memory map file. So in this slide, it is mentioned that a memory map files are those files which are completely mapped in the memory, because they are going to be needed all the time during the execution of the process. So a particular memory map file, like your executable file, is a kind of a memory map file, because that is going to be required all the time for the execution of that particular process. A particular process may require the executable file, DLL, or maybe some any other related data. Sometimes it is also requiring the registry key also. So how we can find out this particular memory map file? So this particular memory map file can be detected, that means we can identify the particular memory file by using the e-process structure. So where a particular memory map file is located in the volatile memory, so that can be identified by using the e-process structure. So once we have located the particular memory map file, then we have to locate the code section of the running of that particular memory map file. Okay, so a particular portable executable file is going to be divided number of sections. As I said, that a particular memory map file or a portable executable file is going to have the first section is a header section. Okay, then it is going to have the code section, then the data section, and any other section for the resources which is going to be used by that portable executable file. So the header section, that is the first section, is going to maintain the metadata of that particular process. Metadata means what is the name of the particular process, the size that is going to be occupied by this particular portable executable file. So such metadata is going to be maintained in the header section. And then we are having the code section. In the code section, it is also called as a text section. The source code of that particular portable executable file is maintained in the code section or the text section. And the data section maintains whatever the data that is required for the running of that portable executable file is maintained in the data section. So what we have to do, we have to locate the presence of the code section in the volatile memory for that particular portable executable file. Once you have located the code section and is how much space is occupied by that particular code section, then we can check whether there is a malware, that means malicious code injection, have been performed by the cyber attacker or not. Certainly we are required to know whether there is any kind of some event had occurred onto that system, or suppose some process is running even though and it is consuming more resources, that means the CPU time unnecessarily, even though a particular process have not started by the particular user of the system, but still that particular process is running and it is consuming the system resources like a central processing unit time. So certainly that particular process becomes suspicious, and in that case we are required to do the analysis of that particular running process. Now this particular process cannot be considered as cannot be detected by the antivirus program, because that is something or legitimate process running on the system. So the signature will be okay, that means for the antivirus program the signature of that process will be it will be verified by the antivirus program that is a legitimate. And then, but the code section, certainly the antivirus program won't be having the access to the code section of that particular process. So in that case we are required to perform the volatile memory dump. Okay, so in that case how we can do the dump of that volatile memory? So for that purpose we have to use the dump IT tool in order to cause the dump of that volatile memory. So by using the dump IT tool, we are going to have the file which will be created for the, that means a memory image will be created, and that memory image file is going to have the extension .raw. So once we have created this .raw file, we have to use the tool like OS Forensics and the Windows Debugger tool. So in this case, the experimentation that I have carried out in order to find out the relationship between the various structures to locate the code section of the particular portable executable file, I have performed the experimentation on the Windows 32-bit operating system. So the Windows 32-bit operating system, I have analyzed, that means the volatile memory image of that Windows 32-bit operating system, I have analyzed and identified the relationship between the various volatile memory structure to locate the code sections of the running process. So once we have located the code section and we have identified how much space is allocated for that code section or is required for the code section, then we can analyze the content of that code section physically, and then we can identify if there is something wrong information is available in the code section from the original code section of that particular portable executable. So that way we can detect the malicious code injection, that means we can do the comparison of the current code section, whatever the code is there in that code section, and with the previous code section, that means from the original code section of that running process for the portable executable file. So that way we can detect whether some malicious code injection have been there or not. If there is a mismatch in the code of both the code section, that means the original code section of that particular portable executable file and the current code section that we have checked from the volatile memory dump. If there is any kind of mismatch is identified between these two code section, in that case we can come to the conclusion that there is some code injection had occurred. So that way we can detect the presence of a malware in the volatile memory. So now how we can detect the memory map file? So for that purpose we have to know the various structure, like in this diagram, in the figure 2, that is the link between the various memory structure related to the mapping of process information to physical pages. So we are required to know the various structure like e-process structure, VAT structure and page table. Okay, now the e-process structure is something which is created when a particular process is created, when the first time a particular running process is created, at that time in the volatile memory the e-process structure is created, and this e-process structure is having the signature PRO. So this is a text signature. From that we can identify that the particular e-process structure. So from the starting of the e-process structure to the 632 byte location, a particular structure is available, that is a VAD root, one of the field. Not it is not a structure, it is a attribute. And this particular attribute, that is a VAD root, it maintains the virtual address of the VAD root. Okay, so the virtual address of the VAD tree is maintained in the VAD root field. Now what is this VAD tree? So whatever the files, maybe your portable executable file or DLL file or any other data that is required for a running process, so that particular data is required to be brought into the volatile memory for the in order to allow the execution, in order to make the execution of the process to happen. Now these particular files, they are required to be allocated some space in the volatile memory. How we can identify the space that is allocated for that particular files or data in the volatile memory term, in the volatile memory? So the VAD, that is a virtual address descriptor, so that maintains the space of the allocated files for a running process in the volatile memory. So whatever the space, the range of the space that is allocated for a file which is associated with the running process, so the individual VAD in the VAD tree maintains the details of that. That means it maintains the individual VAD virtual address descriptor, maintains the address range for the individual files associated with the running process. So you may have at the top a VAD root, okay, under that we will be having a various VAD. Okay, so it's a VAD tree is a hierarchical tree structure. So at the top we are having the VAD root, and from the VAD root below that, at the next level we are having the various VAD which specifies the space, the memory space range allocated to the individual files. Now for every files, let's say we are having a word.exe is a some running process. So word.exe file may have some file, okay, let's say xyz.doc file. So xyz.doc file will have a VAD associated with that. That means this particular document where it have been loaded into the volatile memory, starting address to the ending address. So that space is identified by using the VAD. So a particular, as we are not knowing that in the virtual memory, if you are having the paging concept, paging technique, so we'll be having the main memory divided number of pages. So what is the starting address of the first page for the file which is mapped into the volatile memory? So that address and to the last page is starting address. So that address range is going to be maintained in the VAD. So each VAD is allocated for the individual files. So now all these VADs are created or represented in a tree structure for the particular process. So that's why this VAD root plays an important role to identify all the particular files associated with the running process. So from the VAD root we can go and visit the individual files. In the VAD which is identified by the text signature VAD, so you can see here the text signature is specified VAD. So it is going to have the various attributes like ending VPN, first proto PTE and the subsection. Now each of these particular attributes are having their importance. Now first we'll see the first proto PTE. So this first proto PTE is a particular attribute which maintains the virtual address of the page table. Okay, so from this one we can go to the page table, and which is identified by the signature MMST. So in the page table, so from the beginning of the page table, that is MMST, okay, so to the 24 bytes we are having the base address. So the base address is nothing but the starting address, the first page, whatever the first page that is allocated for this particular file, which is being mapped by, which is being, whose address range is specified by this WAD. So its first page starting address is specified by the base address, which is 24 bytes from the beginning of the page table. So if you visit this, so this physical address directly in the base address, we are going to get the physical address, not the virtual address. So from the base address, we can go and see the first page, which is mapped for this particular file, which is associated, which is being mapped, or which address range is specified by in this WAD. So its physical address we are able to get from this, from the base address. Now another is ending VPN, that is a virtual page number. So it is a 20 bit. Now here, whatever the experimentation that I have done in order to locate the relationship between the various memory structures, volatile memory structure, I have performed it on the 32 bit Windows 32 bit operating system. So that means the addresses are going to be of 32 bit. Now ending VPN is a 20 bit field. So it is going to be some 20 bit field. Now if we add some 12 bit, now on this you can see here in the figure 1 how we can translate the virtual page number to the physical address. Now this particular ending virtual page number, it gives the ending virtual page number, okay, to whatever the pages that have been used to map a particular file onto the memory, volatile memory. So its last page number, virtual page number, is indicated by using this ending VPN. Similarly, there is a starting VPN, that is the first page. So now we can get the last page address, which is associated with this particular file, which is being mapped, which is being specified by using this WAD, whose range is specified by using the WAD, this current WAD. Now how we can convert this ending VPN, which is of 20 bit, to the physical address of the last page associated with that particular file. So for that purpose, we have to append 12 bit, that is having the zeros, all zeros. Okay, so to the whatever the 20 bit we are having, that virtual page number, so to that 20 bit virtual page number, we have to append 12 more bits. So that will make the 32 bit the last page starting address. So here you can, in the diagram, that is in the figure 2, you can see that the base address gives the starting address of the first page, which is being mapped in the file, and that is whose address range is specified by this WAD, and its last page of that particular file is obtained by using this ending VPN. So how we are converting this ending VPN, that is the ending virtual page number, by appending 12 bit zero zeros, all zeros, to this 20 bit ending VPN, and that gives the physical address of the last page, which is being mapped for a file in the volatile memory. So that way we can locate a particular memory map file and its all pages in the particular volatile memory. Now the just here in this case, we are discussed about the first prototype PTA, which gives the starting address. Directly we are obtaining the physical address of the first page for that particular file, whose address range is specified by this WAD. Apart from that, we can use the starting VPN. Okay, so in this first figure 1, you can see that starting VPN is also there, which is of 20 bit, and this starting VPN is also part of the WAD. So by converting this starting VPN, that is 20 bit, to the 32 bit address, again what we have to do, we have to append this 12 bit all zeros to this 20 bit starting VPN. So we will get the 32 bit, and which is going to be the physical address of the first page mapped in the volatile memory for that particular file. So that way also we can get the physical address of the first page, or other way, by using the first proto PTE field of the in the WAD. So these are the techniques for locating the starting address and the ending address of the pages for the particular map, the file which is mapped in the volatile memory. Now, how we can know whether what is the code section of that particular map file? So far we have seen in the last slide that how we can locate the starting pages and the last pages of the memory map file. Now, in order to know what is particular, where is the code section, because everything is going to be in the hex code, what the information that we are going to have in the volatile memory is going to be in the hex code. Certainly for us it will become difficult for us to know what is the code section from its start. So somewhere I told you that that a particular portable executable file is made up of the various section. The first section is the all the time is a header section, which is being followed by a code section. Thereafter we are going to have the data section. For a header section, it is generally having only one page is required to for a header section. That means a particular header section is going to be mapped in the first page. By default, the first page is going to be the header section and it is mapped in only one page. Thereafter, the code section begins. So in case of 32-bit operating system, 4 kilobyte is generally the size of an individual file, individual page. Okay, in case of Windows 32-bit operating system, the size of individual page is 4 kilobyte. The size of individual page in case of Windows 32-bit operating system is 4 kilobyte. So that means after the first 4 kilobyte, there is going to be the code section. But what is the size of the code section? How much space it has occupied or how many pages it has occupied? How we can know? So for that purpose also we have to know the technique for that, so that we can extract the code section from that volatile memory associated with that particular file. So again we have to visit the particular batch structure. Now here I am introducing another structure, volatile memory structure, that is called as a subsection. Now in the VAD entry, VAD structure, already we discussed about the starting VPN and ending VPN. First prototype PT also we have discussed. So from the first prototype PT, what we are able to get, we are directly going to get the first page associated with the map file, and in the first page we are going to have the header section. So thereafter we are having the code section, but we are required to know how many pages have been occupied by the code section. Generally, this particular portable executable file is mapped contiguously, one after another pages. So that way the portable executable file is mapped into the volatile memory. So in the VAD, we are having one of the attribute called as a subsection. Now this subsection attribute contains the virtual address of the subsection structure, the first subsection structure. Now this particular subsection structure, that is a header section, header, that means certainly it is going to be for the header section of the portable executable file. So this particular subsection structure, which is maintained, which is for a particular first section, it maintains two fields of importance. First is a next subsection, another is a PTE in subsection. Next subsection maintains the virtual address of the next subsection of that particular portable executable file, which is mapped in the volatile memory. So by converting this particular virtual address to the physical address, so we can get the subsection structure of the next section, that is the code section. Now how we can convert the virtual address to the physical address? For that purpose we have to use the Windows debugger. If you are doing the physical analysis, physical volatile memory analysis, in that case we have to use the command VTOP onto the Windows debugger, and then we can get the physical address of that particular virtual address. Now the PT in subsection, another field which of importance in the subsection structure, is PTE in subsection. So this indicates the page table entry in the subsection. That means how many pages have been allocated for this subsection in the page table. So that is indicated here in the PTE in subsection. Certainly it is going to be some values, integer values. So that is going to be available in this particular PTE in subsection. So certainly for the header section, the PTE in subsection is going to be 1, because only one page is required for the header subsection of the portable executable file, which is mapped into the memory, volatile memory. Now if you see the subsection code, that is for the code subsection, this field is of importance, PTE in subsection. So from this particular PTE in subsection, we can know how many pages, contiguous pages, have been allocated for the code section. So once we have known that how many pages have been allocated for the code section, then we are able to extract the entire code section associated with that running process of the particular portable executable file. So once we have extracted this code section, then we'll be able to analyze that code section with the already stored code section, okay, for that particular portable executable file. And we can compare that code section with the original code section of that running process. And if there is a mismatch is found out, if any hex code are different, then we can say that, we can assume that there is something, a wrong thing or some injection had occurred in the code section of the current executable file, which is in the volatile memory. So that way we can detect the code section. That means we can detect the presence of the malicious code in the volatile memory. That means if a code injection have been performed in the running process, then we can detect that by using this technique. So the important thing is that how we can know that that particular file is a portable executable file. Certainly a particular running process is going to have so many files associated with that. Already said that a particular process is going to have the portable executable file. It can have some data file associated with that, or it may have some another resource file. So in that case, how we can know that whatever the VAD we have identified of that particular associated with the running process, so we'll be visiting individual VAD. Certainly we are required to visit individual VAD in the VAD tree structure for that particular process, and then we have to know that whether that particular VAD, whatever the range memory space that have been specified by the VAD, okay, for a particular memory map file, whether it is a portable executable file or not. Because in case of running process, the portable executable file is of importance. Because if a code injection has to happen, it will be done onto the portable executable file itself. So that's why we have to know whether a particular file which is being mapped and which address range is specified by the VAD, whether it is a portable executable file or not. So how we can know that? So for that purpose, the control area of the particular subsection plays an important role. So how we can know the control area of a particular subsection? Now again we have to visit the various structure, volatile memory structure, to know whether a particular file which is associated with a running process is a portable executable file or not. So we have to know the eProcess structure, VAD root, its attribute. We visit the VAD, identify the subsection volatile memory address, and get the starting subsection address. Okay, so first of all, the first subsection of a particular file is going to be a header section. Now in the subsection, the one of the field is a control area. Now in the control area, this particular attribute maintains the virtual address of the control area structure. In the control area structure, from the beginning of the control area structure, now the control area structure is having the signature MMCA. Okay, the text signature for the control area is MMCA in the volatile memory dump. from the beginning of that MMCA tech signature to the 28 bytes, we are having one of the attribute called as a flag. So this particular flag attribute is there from the beginning of the control area structure to the 28 bytes. So for the flags, if we are having the values that is set is 40A0. Okay, if for the control area of a subsection, if the value is set as 40A0, it means that is a portable executable file. So for a particular portable executable file, the control area field is going to have the flag value set as 40A0. So that way we can detect, so whatever the VAT and its memory map file, we are searching whether it is a portable executable file or not. And once we have identified that this particular VAT is having the address range for the portable executable file, then we are required to go and search for the various section. That means we have to search for the mainly the code section. And then once we obtain the code sections of the particular portable executable file mapped into the volatile memory, then we have to extract that code section. And then we have to compare that extracted code section with the original code section of the same running process, which we may have maintained in some database. And once we compare that, both the code section, and if there is any dissimilarity is found out in both of the code section, then we can say that there is a code injection had occurred into the particular running process. So that way the technique works. Now there are mainly two kinds of tools which are available to detect the presence of malicious code injection in the running process. So there is a volatility tool and the recall tool. Now both of these tools, they searches for the particular virtual protect X flag. Now these are both the tools, they support some malfind plugin. Okay, so there is a particular kind of a plugin which is supported by the volatility and the recall, that is a malfind. So certainly this malfind plugin is going to search for the malware, presence of the malware in the running process. How it searches? It searches for the virtual protect X flag associated with the running process. That means with the portable executable file, for a particular portable executable file, if the virtual protect X flag associated with the code section of the running process is not fixed by the attacker, then only we can detect the presence of malware. So in order to do some changes to the code section of the particular portable executable file and its code section, the attacker, what it will do, it will change the virtual protect X flag so that it can allow the injection is enabled, so that the particular attacker can do the injection. So it is required to do the changes to this virtual protect X flag. Suppose the attacker have forgotten to reverse back the changes, in that case only this malfind plugin will be able to detect the presence of malicious code. So that way the volatility and the recall tool works. So that's it. So in this particular video, we have discussed the technique to locate the code sections of the particular portable executable file associated with the running process. And once we have detected the code section, then we can check the presence of malicious code. If a malicious code have been injected into the code section, then we can identify that. So hope you must have liked this particular video. So if you like this particular video, don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see the future video on the digital forensics. Thank you.